Pro Football Focus is a little bit higher on this Falcons team than the other two. It actually has them in their simulations, of course, at 9.1 wins. So significantly over the 7.5 that you get right there with them, and actually have them power ranked as the 18th power ranked team leading into the season. So this is where it is kind of cool to take in everybody's opinions on all these things, because some people, you know, decide to get higher on teams or lower on teams. And in Pro Football Focus seems to be a little bit higher on this Falcons team. Now, the offensive line is where they're, you know, this is one of the biggest things here. So left tackle Jake Matthews, he's been a stud pass blocker for them. He's 8th out of 95 qualifiers last season. Run blocking is his middle of the pack, but overall super, super solid guy. Right tackle Caleb McGarry, he was actually their 2019 first-round pick. He took a huge second-year leap. Offensive lineman, you know, whenever we see this type of leap, he went from a 53 to a 64. We see these huge kind of third-year leaps a lot of times from offensive linemen, and so that's what they're going to be hoping for, because they also have another 2019 first-rounder in Chris Lindstrom who's going to start at guard for them. But he was actually the 9th-graded overall guard in the entire NFL last season. So this offensive line has the potential for sure. The big blow here, and the reason why people aren't jumping up and down about this offensive line and saying, oh, hey, look, with these playmakers and Matt Ryan, whatever, is, well, they lost Alex Mack in free agency. And he was the second, he's been the second highest graded center since he came in the NFL in 2016. So over the last 6 years, the guy has been the second, you know, the one of the very best centers that you're ever going to get. He's now over in Cleveland. And so not only do you have to replace him, but there's also a pretty big battle going on over at left guard as well. And the two guys that are really battling it out are both below average, like left guards as well. So there's going to be two pretty gaping holes in that offensive line. And so unless somebody really, really steps it up, that's why people really aren't jumping up and down about the offensive line here, despite the fact that three of the spots should be actually pretty good. On the defensive line, and this is what Kelly was alluding to, look, defensive line, 31st graded heading into the season. Grady Jarrett is actually a legitimate stud for this team. He's actually super, super good. He just has absolutely no help. I mean, they signed Dante Fowler Jr. expecting him to come in and really make a difference for them. He had a below 40 run grade against him, and he had a sub 10% pressure rate as well on the quarterback. And so you give this guy all this money, you sign him in free agency, and then he can't stop the run, and he doesn't get any pressure on the quarterback. He's not really doing his job, all that. I mean, they do get Marlon Davidson back, who was injured for the majority of the season, so he maybe could give them a boost, but it looks like it's going to be a real big weakness here. But maybe not as big a weakness as the secondary, which, by the way, is graded dead last heading into the season. They were dead last year. They are dead last heading into this season. They allowed 7 yards per pass play last year. Only the Jags and Lions allowed more than that. The all four safeties for this team that got at least 200 snaps are all gone. They have to replace every single safety on the team. They don't have anybody returning. Their three primary corners, A.J. Terrell, Isaiah Oliver, and then Kendall Sheffield, all of them over the last two seasons, not just last season, this is like a two-season body of work here, none of them have graded over a 60 over the last two seasons. It's just been horrible for this secondary, and it looks like it's going to be even worse as they have to replace everybody at safety, and then they have three sub-third of the league corners that they're going to be running out there.
So, like, that's something we brought up, like, during the season last year, I felt like, where it was like, okay, like, Keanu Neal, like, I think that's one thing, but, like, okay, if you were that bad, replacing like everybody, like, is it really gonna get, how much worse can it get? You know what I mean? Like, I guess you don't really know with that. I mean, that's what I'm saying with that. You need to replace people that have been playing that bad.
Where is Deion Jones ranking these days?
Deion Jones is not he's not showing up very, very highly in these things either. You know, I mean, and if you're a Falcons fan, you see this right here. I mean, this is like, you know, where they're going to finish in this division. You're relying on the skill position stuff, and like we said, for this offensive line to be able to be good enough to where, hey, look, they're just going to get in firefights, and maybe you win some of these firefights, right? I mean, we talked about this on the show, and Gil, we got backed up by these people who watched the tape every single down. Matt Ryan was a 12th graded quarterback in 2020. Like, everyone was putting this guy in his grave.
Pronouncements of his demise are premature.
And you want some players that he finished better than as far as, like, over the course of the season? Kyler Murray, Justin Herbert, Matt Stafford, Phillip Rivers, Drew Brees. He was ahead of every single one of those guys, you know? And it was – everyone was trying to say that it was his fault. It wasn't his fault. It was the defense's fault. They were getting these leads. We just mentioned that they had halftime leads in 9 games, you know, that the defense could not hold for them at all. One of the questions here, though, I think that this is a legitimate concern if you are kind of wondering how this offense is going to translate over with Arthur Smith, because the way he ran this Tennessee team is the Titans passed the ball a league low 42% of the time on early downs and situation neutral, because maybe that had to do with the fact that you've got Derrick Henry. But maybe that's an offensive philosophy, right? And so we'll see how it all plays out here, because you would like to think that when you have Calvin Ridley and you invested the 4th overall pick in Kyle Pitts, that you're going to be using these guys, you know, and passing a ton, because Calvin Ridley, again, top 10 wide receiver. Kyle Pitts, I think, is going to have a monster season. We have the over-under up there, 800.5 on Kyle Pitts. I actually bet that, and I took the over on –
So glad you brought that.
I actually bet that and took the over on that. I took that 2 days ago. It was as I was kind of prepping for all this, because when you look at it, he's basically going to be a wide receiver.
You're right.
I mean, like, for this team, on a team that's going to be trailing a lot
and over throwing the ball just as much as they have the past 3 years.
Who's going to be trailing a lot over the course of the season. And I think, and we've tried hard to explain what kind of a physical freak that this guy is. But, I mean, it is crazy. Another missed kick. He's gone. Pack your bags, buddy. They're getting someone else in there. But, I mean, he's absolute physical. We're talking a 6'6 guy that runs a 4.49. I mean, this is like Calvin Johnson-esque.
Athletic ability. Literally text me. I have Calvin. He said I have Kyle Pitts over 790.5. How high should it go before I middle it? I said, stop with the middling. Just take your 7.9 and a half.
Matt, I was putting together, of all these teams we've done and all the player totals, that one made me stop in my tracks more than anyone I've put together so far, where I was like, and usually you think overs with rookie stars, that's going to be a popular bet, right?
Blake? Well, the people who look at it and they say, no tight end's ever done this. Yeah. They start naming off all these stats. One, no tight end's ever been taken 4th overall in the draft ever before. No tight end's ever been 6'6 and run a 4.4 before. Like, there is no comps, right? There's no comps.
I mean, this guy averages 50 yards a game. You're going over that.
He's going to line up, it's not even typical tight end type situation. He's going to line up wide at least half the time. Like, he's gonna, and it's not even like he's gonna be tight end, you know. He's not blocking. They have Hunter, they have Hayden Hurst.
He's not blocking.
He didn't block. They have Hayden Hurst to block. He's not blocking ever.
There is a team every year in the NFL, whether it's AFC or NFC, that no one expects to make the playoffs, or very few people expect to make the playoffs, but does. And I'm not talking about the Patriots in the AFC. That doesn't count. It's Belichick. I think it might be the Falcons. Because of all the things we talked about, all those close losses last year, I would not be surprised at all to see them squeak into a playoff berth. That number 2 at +300, finishing 2nd in the South, I might bet that.